Okay, hello everybody. I'm very, very glad to welcome you here the Vienna Humanities Festival. We are in a very interesting series of talking about power and powerlessness, and I think our discussion tonight, or today, this afternoon, will placed suited very well into the discourse. Is that right? Yeah. I would like to introduce you. I'm Zsuzsanna Szelényi. I'm a former Hungarian politician. At the moment, I'm a fellow at the Institute for Human Sciences. And I'm very pleased to invite and welcome Mr. Béla Greskovits, who is my fellow Hungarian, a university professor at the Central European University. Béla is at the university professor at the Department of International Relations and also the Department of Political Sciences. His research interest is political economy of the transition in East Central Europe, obviously, comparative economics development, social movement, and democratization. Everything what we have went over in the last decades in Hungary and in the region, I believe. And Béla is also an award winner researcher on various issues of his book. A couple of years ago, he got the Steinrocken Prize for Comparative Social Science Research, also the CU Award for Outstanding Research, and a number of other wonderful awards. So I'm really very pleased to have you here. And today we will discuss one of your projects, an ongoing project, if I understand, on social movements, specifically something which has been going on in Hungary in the last years. I'd like to quote something which I read from your research, but of course any Hungarian would know this quote, something that Viktor Orban said in 2002, just right after when he lost elections as a prime minister. So this was a moment when he was in government and he lost the elections. And there were a couple of weeks after the election, there was a huge demonstration in Budapest, and he gave a speech which became very famous and very often quoted in Hungary since then, when he said, "Civic Hungary is not one smaller or larger part of this country. It is the whole. Even if our parties and elected representatives might be in opposition in the parliament, we, all those present this square, will not and cannot be in opposition, because it is impossible for the nation to be in opposition. It's only a government that may end up in opposition to its own people if it fails to act in the nation's interest. There is one flag, there is one camp." Well, this is really a very telling, a very strong speech. Has anything started, something special in Hungary in 2002? Well, I give the floor, and I'm very, very interestingly looking for your presentation.
Yeah, thank you, Zsuzsa, for this very kind, thought-provoking introduction. I'm very happy to be here and share with you some ideas and findings of an ongoing research on the social basis of the emerging right wing in Hungary and beyond, focusing for now empirically on the Hungarian case. So those who were previously present in this room got a lecture on the power of powerlessness, of the powerless. Now, this my lecture is about the power of the powerful, the sources of the power of the powerful. And to cut my longer story short, the sources of the power of the powerful in this case lie in civic activism and social protest, striving for hegemony. And let me start with an international context, actually, in which I want to locate the Hungarian case. This intellectual context is something that we all know about. It is the double attack worldwide against liberalism. Why double? Because liberalism, on the one hand, is attacked as economic neoliberalism. Could you please? Sorry, we have some technical. So the next. So it is liberalism worldwide is attacked as associated with neoliberal economic strategies of globalization, creating and exacerbating social inequality. But what is more puzzling in the current situation, that this attack on economic neoliberalism is also coupled with attacks, often by the same people, politicians, against liberalism as an emancipating political project. And here the argument is that yes, it is emancipating, but it is emancipating the wrong actors. Women against men, non-whites against whites, gays, lesbians, causes of the environment. That is wrong, that should be stopped. Wherever these two kind of criticisms and attacks of against liberalism can be merged into a political project that will become close to something of a winning formula, or at least a lot of important background for emerging political forces. Here comes the interest of the Hungarian case, which is relevant because in Hungary this kind of anti-liberal movement became hegemonic and became extremely resilient. By resilience, what I mean is that this is a very successful, a remarkably successful political project. We are talking about 6 victories at national, European parliament and local elections in a row. And several other victories are in sight. So basically this march towards victory started in 2010, and since then it is going on. Now, another interesting aspect of the Hungarian case is that if we analyze empirically how in Hungary this happened, this helps to understand how actually an anti-liberal political project can become hegemonic. And the third issue which is clear in the Hungarian case is that many analyses of these anti-liberal political projects worldwide put the stress on something which we associate as uneducated, aggressive, angry masses falling prey to the populists. The neglected white working class in the United States. I guess the issue has some resonance in Austria today, and in particular in Wien as well. So people who are basically powerless and who are captured by populists. Now, my research on the Hungarian case sheds light on a different kind of actors. Middle class, educated, conservative, religious, partly intellectual, partly entrepreneurial social groups. These are the basis of the civic circles. So let me now show the main argument. The main argument of my work and of this presentation also is that the resilience and power of Viktor Orban's regime is originally rooted in its success in capturing Hungarian civil society, which Viktor Orban and his party achieved over 8 years in opposition when left and liberal parties were in power in Hungary. So in some sense, some socialist politician once quipped that Orban did not win his 2/3 in elections on the lottery. he worked hard for it. I think this is actually true. Now, the major actor in this fight for Hungarian civil society, in which the left and liberal-minded civil society lost out, were the Civic Circles Movement, which were founded by Viktor Orban in 2002. Zsuzsa mentioned, actually, the speech, which was the founding document of the Civic Circles. Now, what I am talking now, from now about, is based on a database of about 5,000 events organized between 2002 and 2006 by the Civic Circle movements, both in Hungary and the neighboring countries, among the Hungarian ethnic minorities of the neighboring countries, based on which I define the Civic Circles movement as a massive mobilization of militant, metropolitan and urban, and educated middle classes. What does it mean, massive? We are talking about a movement that had about 20,000 or more units nationwide. These were sometimes small, sometimes bigger ones, sometimes just a couple of people, sometimes they had hundreds of members. The movement was also massive because while nobody knows the exact numbers, we are talking about more than 100,000 educated people who acted in various ways as activists for the movement. Now, this is a large number in a country where the combined number of all the political parties around that time was about 100,000 too, right? This is one third of the entire trade union membership. Moreover, the movement and its units were strongly internetworked. So basically, they were circulating electronic messages. We are before the Facebook age, before Facebook and Twitter, right? But internet was already heavily in use, and the movement utilized it, right? Now, the second aspect is militant. I am still with explaining the features. Militant. The movement organized many protests. But these protests were very rarely violent. Basically, never really. They were partly big organized marches, rallies, demonstrations, but most of the protest was petitions, right? So these were basically, this tells also about the educated middle class character of the movement. These were graphomaniac people who basically, like all of us, exchanged their messages and their protest through petitions. Metropolitan and urban. Out of the 5,000 or so events, two-thirds of the events were organized by big cities or the capital itself, or the larger Budapest agglomeration. The rest in smaller towns, villages, or in the neighboring countries. Right? And then I already told about the educated middle classes. What we have in mind here is basically religious conservative lawyers, priests, teachers, entrepreneurs, media pundits. Why is this important? Because the current left liberal government of the time characterized the movement as sort of right-wing mobs ruling the streets, violent and so on. So there was some misunderstanding there based on my own research. Let's go further then, okay? So what were the powers of this movement? Basically three things. It was integrative. It has very concrete agenda for civic organization. And it had been very successful in creating attachments to important, what can be called, imagined communities, the nation, Christianity, citizenry, and the European Union. So let me explain a little bit. Integrative, because the movement managed to integrate all factions of the Hungarian right. In detail, the Christian national middle class, the populist national middle class, and for some time also various groups of the far right, the radical right. In addition to this, based on specific problems, issue areas, the movement even could cooperate with those movements which cannot be defined as right. Peace movements, this was the period of the Iraq War, the civic circles and the peace movement very often demonstrated together against the Iraq War in Hungary, environmentalists, very often even pro-poor movements, as well as small trade unions and certain streams of the left in Hungary. Not, however, the left and left liberal parties which ruled the countries. They were considered as adversaries, in stronger term, enemies, right? Then elaborate agendas. So the movement was very consciously planned. Just give you one example. It was a masterpiece in organizational sense in the way that, for instance, in 2002 fall, one center of the movement organized a competition in which the various civic circles had to write small essays about their best practices, and then the movement was circulating the best practices. The study that won this competition was called Recapturing Everyday Life and the Holidays. And it is a 60 pages long, pretty interesting manual about how to reinvent the various cultural forms, holidays, everyday activities of the right, from charity to protest, from bars to going to concerts and so on. So manuals existed also about how to protest against unacceptable media content, right? So there was a very concrete agenda here which these people used. And the third is attachments, building strong attachments. Now, why do you need to build attachments to issues like the nation? Because we are not born Hungarians, Austrians, Americans. We learn how to be. Arguably, in a post-socialist, post-communist situation, where people were not allowed to freely exercise their Hungarianness, Christianity, and so on, this was even more important. So many of the events organized by the movements were actually aimed at training Hungarians to be Hungarians, being members of the European Union, giving, of course, certain interpretations of these terms, and so on. And this was basically done in everyday encounters during lectures, sessions, organizations like, you know, in German you would call them Volkshochschule. So basically adult educational establishments were widely used here. Now what you see here is basically pictures about the various offers of the interpretations of the nation the civic circle movement offered. And this is basically inductive. So we see here the usual way, you know, local patriotism, that's nothing new about it, we know what that is. But we also see imaginations of Hungary in Europe. There you see my passport, basically having the ancient Corona Sacra and the Hungarian coats of arms, but then it's a European Union passport. So there the concept was Europe is our future, Hungary is our country. So it was about basically a Europe in which Hungary is first, always first, never second. Let me just add that during this period, German Christian democracy appeared to be very supportive of Orban's civic circles. Hans-Georg Pöttering, Helmut Kohl regularly visited meetings and talked to young people there, right? Then, of course, the most important concept of nation was Hungary of the 15 million, which included not just the 10 million people who are living within the boundaries of current Hungary, but the whole cultural nation, so people also living in the neighboring countries, right? So this is the concept to which most of the events and communication within the circles were related. So if you are interested in the symbolics of the bread there, you can ask in the question answer session. I would like to go now further. This is just an idea, give you an idea about that some of the small and medium-sized native entrepreneurs also joined and were very supportive of the movement. Now, these were actually people who were not just native Hungarians, but had all kinds of ideas about, you know, how to build a national bourgeoisie, right? Something that I summarize here as folk economic nationalism, which has actually some grounding for the economic nationalist policies of the current Orban government, right? As you see, national symbolics fuses here with bioproduction, farmers markets, and so on. It's a wonderful postmodern mix. Let's go further. And a next feature is the omnipotence and omnipresence of historical churches, Roman Catholic, Calvinist, mainly churches, so Protestant churches. This is visible both in the sites where the civic circle events were organized. About 20% or more of the events were organized in church-bound gymnasiums, universities, nursery, elderly homes, monasteries, or actual churches. The church also provided a very strong intellectual manpower and partly women power, because priests, nuns, and religion-bound intellectuals often talked about issues for the civic circles. And the last, the themes were very often related to the religion. The last thing here, I don't go in detail here again, this was also the period where the right started to build its media empire, actually from very minimal beginnings. There was that time indeed a left liberal and commercial media dominance, which was challenged by the movement. Let's get to the last. Okay, I don't want to talk about this. Maybe if you want to ask, this is more about the legacy of the civic circles. Let's go to the last. Okay, I have some questions, which is more for further research. My research, but probably they are interesting otherwise. The first thing is, how could all this happen in a period of 8 years of successive left and liberal governance? How could the left and liberals so miserably lose out in civil society? Is this a post-communist phenomenon where the left is in a difficult situation? Is it a more broad phenomenon? Is it a policy mistake? More generally and positively, how can the left and liberals respond to this kind of challenge? And the last issue is, which I formulate saying, can the rainbow banner learn anything from the tricolor and the cross? Can the left and liberals learn anything from this experience and other similar related experiences of the right. And here the interesting thing is, yes, this was a hegemonic strategy. Viktor Orban himself is very well trained in Gramsci's theory. There is proof for this, right? But then, so is actually, are the post-war, post-materialist, nice, quote-unquote, social movements of environment, gays, feminists, peace movements, pro-poor movements, build up a kind of community-based understanding of the world that unites them and makes them an important challenger to what we see here, both under the national banners and the banner of the church. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you really very much. It's a fascinating story. It is a story that we are living in Hungary. This has obviously plenty of consequences that maintain Viktor Orban's regime in these days. Many things which was developed over the almost a decade before he got to the supermajority were prepared and now are officialized. So there's a lot to speak about, and I would like just to start some of the questions because I believe you are very interested also to target Béla with your questions. Some which might be interesting in an international public, because of course million questions are interesting for a Hungarian here. You say it was a centrist revolution. I think there is a lot of discussion about current political changes in Europe, specifically how far what we see, which often we put into anti-European context or anti-liberal, is coming from the fringes. And then what you say is that it's actually come from the very center. The pillars, the pillar of this anti-liberal, now we know it's an anti-liberal revolution because Viktor Orban called it illiberal, it comes from the center. So do you think it's in the, how does it relate to the European discourse?
So this is of course a question about which it's a great question, and I myself tried to think about it, and one way for me to address this issue is to read as much as I can, even if I cannot do myself empirical research about other kinds of movements, and seek for similarities and differences. And I mentioned three others about which I already read. The Tea Party movement in the United States, the Gülen movement in Turkey, and the current solidarity as compared with the original solidarity. In all of these cases, what I see are two things which are common. In all four movements, middle class people, partly educated, partly propertied, are part of the story. So they are the ones who bring in all those who are more on the margins. So originally they might be on the margin of the politics, but they are not resourceless. They are not powerless. They are powerful. Now the second issue that brings together the center, educated middle classes, and the periphery of the society, that all these movements, similar to what I tried to explain here about the civic circle movements, try to educate. They try to educate people. They have an obsession with educating people, which I find a good thing. Even if what they are educated in Hungary about is partly not my cup of tea. That's not the problem. You know, we all Hungarians should not be all the same. The issue is whether those educated this way and educated other way, in other ways, can talk to each other. Otherwise, you know, it's an illusion to to stay in the same nation. So I think that this revolution cannot be imagined, actually, without the experience and without the strong involvement of educated middle classes. And therefore, I am never really happy with the term of populism. So what I see in Hungary, Orban Viktor is repeatedly told ad nauseam populist. I don't think he's a populist. He's something else. He's more complex. And, you know, I think same might be true in the other cases of the movements which I mentioned. So I think simply I try to understand an aspect of this worldwide change, and this is my simple answer to your question, which I think is under research, not really realized. The role of intellectuals and educated people. And here I have a tough message, because if there is a role, there is responsibility, right? These things are not just happening to us. We are part of them.
Another very interesting thing what they say is about Europe. Yeah, you say that when these people went around speaking about the future, they were very pro-European. And of course, Viktor Orban and current Hungary is very often put into an anti-European corner. Well, what do you think about that? Is this a different kind of Europeanness? When you studied these writings or speeches of the educators who organized the civic circles, what was about Europe? What did they say about Europe? How do we have to imagine a Europe by Viktor Orban and this counter movement?
Yeah, thank you, Zsuzsa. So we both know that actually the first Orban government, which ruled in Hungary between 1998 and 2002, so before the civic circle movement started, was actually pretty pro-European. So they were actively negotiating the Europe agreement, and actually under their government, most of the treaty was signed, right? So they could claim that they are actually pro-European, and even they are more European than the current government, not the current, but the left liberal government in 2002 and 2010, because they not only represent the interests of foreigners, of Europe, but also that of Hungary. So I would say, from my empirical material, what I see is that a large share of the civic circle events was moderated, coordinated, populated by lectures by the technocrats of the Fidesz government, of the previous Fidesz government, who, even if the party was in opposition in 2002-2010, had important positions both in Brussels and in the Hungarian parliament, so they were competent. Of course, parallel to this, and I tried to explain to you that the movement integrated all fractions of the right, you got very strong anti-European streams within the movement. So people from the far right went around across the civic circles and began to talk about, yes, Hungary came from the Soviet Union and now enters the European Union, and what was Moscow before is now Brussels, right? So there was a relatively multifaceted, multicolored understanding of what Europe was. If you want to, would you mind, because this fits now, and I am sure that you are interested in my interpretation of the poster, right? Okay, so can we go back just to the up? Yeah, two more. No, up. Before. Sorry. One more. Two. Yeah, here. Okay, so you see this poster. In my view, this is beautiful. So, just to give you a context, this is done by one of the most famous Hungarian graphics and painters. What you see is a loaf of bread in the form of earlier Greater Hungary, right? This is how Greater Hungary before 1920 looked. What you see there is, however, that this loaf of bread is halved, right? Shared by the Danube, which is the central river of the country. Now, what you see there is yes, again. Why? Because this was a poster done by this artist for a referendum organized in 2004, December. And the referendum was about whether or not Hungary should give a passport to Hungarians living in the neighboring countries, right? Ethnic Hungarians. Now, what is shared here? Current Hungarians share everything they had, their last piece of bread, with Hungarians living in the neighboring countries. If you say yes, you give them a passport. What is this passport? It's a European passport for people living in countries who that time were not yet members of the European Union. So the way Europe and Hungary, and both current Hungary and earlier concepts of Greater Hungary merge, is very nicely visible here and artistically expressed.
Well, so I think it's really nice, and it's very, very wonderfully captured in this place. Probably that has a bit changed since then, because now when it was obviously a pro-European force, now I think the Orban government is still pro-European in a certain sense, but there is good Europe and bad Europe. So they actually divide Europe to ideologically, I would say. So this is again a kind of longer discussion, but I think it's also very nicely come up from your report. Well, I give the floor to the public in a minute. I have just one question before, please then start to think about your questions, about civil society. Because this is a big civic movement, right? However, it's obviously politically led. It follows a political project, a political ideology, and hegemonial requirements or intentions, as you said. So do we have to think differently on civil society as from now, or knowing all these things and this kind of movement?
Yeah, I mean, this is an important question again, Zsuzsa. Thank you very much. And I myself am divided here, right? Because how to call this civic? Is this civic or something else? Okay, 2 points. One, the political contacts, right? I have a hard time to find, and therefore I try to read about other cases, a model of civil society, apart from theoretical models, of course, right? Where you don't find a political link. If I go to the Tea Party, I mentioned you, I love to read about the Tea Party, maybe because of the similarities. My American friends read, you know, the study which is behind this presentation and this is very similar to, anyway. So what I understand there, at least from some work, that the political project there was that the Tea Party mobilized and organized its members to bring back the Republican Party to the real ideals of the US and how. So, and what it achieved is, in effect, pushed or tried to push the Republican Party more to the right, right? Here, what I see in the Hungarian case, there is a different relationship between party and movement. Here it is more a party, the Fidesz party, that played an active role in establishing itself on the ground among the people. And there might be different relationships in different contexts. So So the relationship with politics, you know, speaks to me about real life. So I don't find it necessarily coming from the devil or something that is easy to avoid. Now, in terms of this very, very strict definition of what is civic and what is not civic, I have troubles. I believe that, you know, this very strict definition may not be the solution, but part of the problem. We define civic things that we like, and uncivil that we don't. And probably, you know, it would be a good approach to make that step of and being more embracing, not liking everything, but accepting that, you know, church-bound civic organizations with very, very strong opinions about abortion, gay marriage, and so on, are still civic. It's a different. The question is whether these various organizations can at all speak to each other. Nowadays, I recognize this is a problem in a number of countries, but I don't think it's avoidable. I don't think it's avoidable. So if you want, this is for me a normative rather than positive observation.
Thank you very much. It's really fascinating to learn more about ourselves and our countries and put it into a kind of self-reflective context. I think this your paper helps to do this, and not it's your the floor is yours. You wanted to ask some question?
Thank you very well. I would like to understand whether. Oh, right. I'm David, and I'm a graduate of sociocultural anthropology here from Vienna. Regarding the civic circles, could. If I understand right, it is not sufficient to say that they have been set up, created on behalf or by the Fidesz party. They are something distinct. And if that is right, could that mean that at some point, when perhaps the entire environment of Hungary within and without changes, they could outgrow the Fidesz government or regime, as it is being called? And I also wonder whether Mrs. Szelényi, Zsuzsanna Szelényi, who has been a part of the Fidesz party at some point, I think, and knows the whole story from inside also, would like to give a comment additionally.
Okay, maybe just two more questions. Can you remember the questions? Okay, Mieke here. Yeah, and then the Mieke, and then the gentleman. Here in front, and then the gentleman behind, and then we go on.
Okay. Mieke Verloo, also a fellow at the Institute. My question would be to link more your remark that I agree with in principle, that the problem arises when these groups don't talk to each other anymore. But in order for this to happen, these groups first have to exist, right? So from outside, Orban then instituted rules that civic groups could not get funding from outside anymore. I'm obviously familiar with the feminist and the gay and lesbian movement, who were deeply troubled by this. I would like to ask you, at what point in time were these, let's say, restrictive measures to block out other civil circles that didn't fit into Orban's perspective. When did they start, and what are the impact they have on the existence of these groups? Because that comes obviously before that they can even consider talking to each other.
Okay, maybe the gentleman behind you, not here, and then we will go on. Okay,
My name is Stephen Lukes from New York University. I want to ask you a question about misperception. I mean, your research, like all the best research, is surprising. So I'd like to know why. How do you explain the fact that these left liberal governments in the early 2000s simply didn't see what you discovered? Why did they think this was all the politics of the streets? Why did they not see what you saw?
Okay, lots of questions. So, first your question, David. So, my story is the story of 2002 and 2010, right? So the first period. I did not talk about the current Orban regime, which I don't see as directly basing in power, its power so much on civil organization than on other methods, such as restricting actually the adversaries, right? So civic circles, named as civic circles, exist in much smaller numbers and are even less present in media politics than before. They still exist, but they are not that prominent. Therefore, it doesn't look like they outgrow the party. The party did outgrow them, right? Rather. But the more important aspects I try to discover in your question is that, yes, there is always not only a cooperation, but a conflict with the party and its movements, right? The movements have very different issues to cope with. And this happened during the period that I studied. So the movement partly became more radical. Parts of the movement were absorbed in the party, so they went in all directions. It's never, since this was not a totalitarian power, right? The movement and the party never really went or marched always in the same direction, and it is always not hard to imagine, and it was not the case that Orban called for organizing civic circles and in 2 months there were already 5,000, right? So he is not omnipotent. There was a need, there was a demand, obviously. This is one. And another issue, and Zsuzsa will, the other question is, Stephen Luke. So why didn't they realize? I mean, this is for me a puzzle. There was a tradition of, between the left and the right, calling each other fascists versus communists, right? So the gut reaction of the left liberal power was, these are fascists. Fascists are marginal, so we don't have to deal with them. We tell it 1,000 times in the TV, that's enough. Otherwise, we distribute welfare benefits and everything is done. So there must have been a policy mistake downplaying people's need for identity. A second explanation, possible explanation is that it is difficult to be on the left after communism. Traditional concepts of the left are obviously disqualified, and it is not easy to import new organizational and ideational developments from the West after communism, right? So you can say, yes, this is, yeah, we have an environmental movement. Only its power never ever compares to environmentalists in Germany, Austria, or in happier countries from this respect. So it's very difficult to emulate the history of other countries, right? And the third issue, and in this case, even if the left and liberals were ready to respond, they did not have much in store. They had to reinvent each other or themselves as left and liberals, and this has not gone too far. And the third is that the whole Hungarian story is part of a broader story, a worldwide story. And in this respect, the Hungarian left and liberals show just maybe to some extent in an exaggerated way the weaknesses of the left that you see not only in Hungary but in other countries as well. So this would be my tentative answers. So the surprise maybe comes because the left did not have anything to surprise others with. And your last question is, of course, we are in a very different period, and understanding it is an intellectual challenge for me. So how come, if I am right, that this movement was as I describe it, how did we arrive to the kind of rather expansive power that basically at this moment tries to eliminate, marginalize, silence all of its adversaries? I would say, although of course it's not my cup of tea, I'm not the Orban government's advisor, and you know, in the remaining short time this will not change. I think it's not very smart, but it's their problem. It's sometimes nice to have an opposition. You know, you do something, they reflect on it, they tell where are the weak points, they do for you your research. You can save your research. So it's a phase in which the government really tries to crack down on even not very important enemies, right? Or perceived enemies. And the logic would be maybe related to some expansive strategy of the party. More and more people need position, need university cathedrals. I don't know. So it's still an intellectual challenge for me to see how we arrived from where we are now, from where the whole story started, right?
Okay, we have three more questions. The yellow lady, the monsieur, and Mirjana. And while you take the microphone, I just answer quickly your comment, because you called me. Just take the floor, because it's a fascinating question, of course. I'm just saying that I think Hungarian society today is very, very puzzled. It's a complex scene. We don't know what's behind Viktor Orban. Political leadership or leadership as such is really necessary in order to bring so many people together. So without leadership, you don't go too much, even with a very unhappy civil society. And the lady, okay, that's the way how you work.
Okay, Mirjana Tomic, Forum Journalismus und Medien in Wien. I have a very simple question. This civic movement, which values do they propose? What was their ideal society? Does it exist today, what they proposed? And the second question is, why do people vote for Orban over and over again? What does he offer that people like? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. The values they proposed were very simple. To put it simply, nation, God, family. Nation understood in minimum four ways, so that everybody included, can be feel included, the pro-Europeans, the local patriots, those who believe in a Hungary of 15 million or the community of Hungarians in 15 million, and those who believe that the nation is ancient and goes back to the times, you know, of whatever, you know, Roman Empire. So what I call something like, you know, sacral medievalism, right? So people who learn runiform writing, learn to how to ride, use the arrow and the bow, who are basically, you know, you might find this ridiculous. I don't, actually. Because what they do is deeply postmodern. You know, what our children and in my case, grandchildren do, and what adults do, what do? They read Game of Thrones, watch Star Wars, you know, play and read Tolkien's Lord of the Rings, play with computer games, you know, all these kind of things we do, they are present, they are in fashion. Umberto Eco wrote a very nice essay about it. He calls, you know, the faith in fakes, right? So it's for some reason popular, so that's the fourth. And in terms of religion, they offer a lot of things. They offer a moral base. They offer some interpretation of, you know, religion. Hungary is not a particularly religious country. But, you know, a few million people who believe, who are religious, that's quite an important basis. Now, you know, family. Yes, you know, it's in a country where the population is you know, on the decline. People don't have children. This has not started, obviously, with the transition or the Orban regime. This is a much longer period. It's about a lot of things. It's about legalizing drugs, exposing your children to it. Is it good for children to have talk shows in the TV and so on and so forth? So these were actually issues that reached many people, or, you know, reinterpreting holidays, Christmas. The idea here was the fact that we start our shoppings for Christmas in late October has nothing to do with the holiday, right? It has to do with transnational corporations who want to sell us their stuff. And it has to start late November, October, right? So the idea there was, let's return to the family tradition of the holiday, to Jesus, love, small presents. Anyway, people cannot afford, you know, buying so much and so on. So, you know, these kind of ideas, some might like them, others don't, but that they have the right to exist, right, is not questionable, at least for me, right? So then the next issue that you ask is why Orban is so popular. Now, this is voted. It's a very complex story. You know, I have a separate article about it and cannot answer, actually.
We listen to both questions after each other, and then you will have a final. Because
okay.
I see, yes, that there's a lot of interest, but we unfortunately have to stop at a certain point.
I wanted to ask whether this civic movement was, or civil circles, were not also in the core also somehow racistic, that there was always some racism as a part of it, which is also the basis now for being against foreigners, against migrants, of some anti-Semitic rhetorics. The anti-Soros campaign is very often also linked that this has also an anti-Semitic core. And race, if I think of racism, I think, of course, of the considerable Roma minority in Hungary. So the ideal of the Hungarian society based on Hungarian dom, I don't know another word, is it not, was it not always an illusion?
Köszönöm szépen. Thank you very much. I'm Adrian, a barrister at law from London and Vienna, and I'd like to pick up on the last point, because it dovetails very well. That I've got two questions about paradoxes. The first one, after the Second World War, there arose what I thought myself was a pro-liberal democratic socialism compared to the Arrow Cross fascist movement. I dare say the name that existed during the Second World War. Is there a lurch now in Hungary back to the Arrow Cross fascist movement? And secondly, picking up on the Georg Schröder's point that I don't think was mentioned in your talk, is there a paradox here that his European University has been kicked out of Hungary? Why is it so? And did Georg Soros, who broke the Bank of England, galvanize the momentum of the right-wing factions rather than fractions with his views paradoxically, he himself was a student of Sir Karl Popper of the London School of Economics, who wrote about the open society and its enemies. Orban wants him out, but has Orban set up civic circle groups that are in fact representative or surrogates of Sir Karl Popper's open society?
Okay, thank you very much. Well, kind of final round.
Yeah, thank you again for the questions. So I can tell you something. The evidence I have read on the civic circles, events and communications exceed 5,000 pages. I have not seen an anti-Roma comment, a single one. A single one. The anti-Roma issue and the issue of racism came up more on the far right. So basically, I didn't tell you that most of these circles actually did not, were not established in the smallest villages with large Roma populations and so on. So Fidesz during this time, and even its grassroots, didn't have a racist approach to the Roma issue, or at least I don't see any sign of it. What I see in turn is that actually there was a sort of traditional, partly church-bound, charitable approach to the Roma as poor, right? So they were collecting actually in kind and monetary donations for the Roma. So this was an issue during this period, and actually increasingly after 2004, 2005 of the far right, the Jobbik party. They brought up powerfully the anti-Roma agenda in politics. Second, there was some sort of coded anti-Semitism present, not very strongly in the communication I read of the civic circles, but this was more this classical anti-capitalist variant. Capitalism is bad, creating inequalities, global capitalism. Who creates inequalities? Banks. Who are the bankers? And then, yes, the benefactor of my institution was already mentioned during this time, right? But this was, again, not comparable. So there was no anti-Soros campaign or anything like that. And therefore, it is not an easy intellectual task to understand what I thought, how we came here, where we are from there. It's not a natural, organic development, in my view. It's something else, okay? I cannot reflect on, about CEU, my university. So our rector was here yesterday and gave a talk. So I don't think I could add anything to that, right? About the racism of current political actors in Hungary and the civic circles movement, I told you what I could, right? So it's of course a big debate. I actually never use the term fascism for the Orban regime. I think it helps as little as the term populism. I like very much Hirschman. I am a follower of Albert Hirschman. He has an article called "The Search for Paradigms as a Hindrance to Understanding." Right. Now, I think populism and fascism in the Hungarian case are these paradigms. They are hindrances to understanding. I don't know whether this satisfies you.
Well, I think we have to stop. However, we haven't answered everything which came out from your research, which in my understanding is about really to understand that after a huge frustration, which was losing the election in 2002, with a relative middle-class elite part of the society who were actually on power before. They were the the closest environment of the government between 1998 and 2002. So they just lost a little bit. You know, there was a lot of people very unhappy. So I think that was this kind of rage. I mean, this is not exactly this rage that that many people speaking about. It was a kind of very actual rage, plus the program and a political leader. This created a very unique environment, and I think it's really important that we learn about that. And very easy to put Hungary to kind of anti-European, fascistoid type of regime. But I understand your story that it's a bit misleading. And if we only, well, I don't say that there are no certain similarities and of course learning points, because there are, but then we are not on the right track. And then we make a mistake, which the Hungarian social liberal elite made over almost a decade, completely neglecting this huge mass of Hungarians who really went for something. And I think as a politician, for me, it's very important that just base your program on unhappiness and frustration is just not enough. You really have to offer an alternative. And if I can say so, I think this is quite a program for today, also in Europe, not only in Hungary. Well, thank you really much to join us. And well, Béla is around, so you can target him in the break. Thank you very much for coming.